Julie, and we'll just let them in as they arrive and we'll get started. Okay, so I'm just going to change here. I'm going to introduce, I'm going to start recording now just so everyone is aware. I'm going to start the recording.
I recorded, Nicole, you're good.
Oh, sorry, oops. All right, okay, here we go. Okay, so on your screen is our guest. Our Jamie Drake is our wonderful guest this afternoon. And actually, I just want to do a little shout out to Dagmar. So thank you, Dagmar, for connecting us with Jamie. So a little bit about Jamie. So Dr. Jamie Drake is a Toronto-based percussionist, drummer, and composer whose musical interests span from chamber music to Motown. He received his DMA at the University of Toronto, studying with Eun Huang and Russell Hartenberger. He has premiered works by composers Christos Hadzis, John Luther Adams, and Nicole Lisée, and performed with Soundstreams, Niagara Symphony, Aradia, Amici, Kingston Symphony, Nexus, and many others. As a member of the Torque Percussion Quartet, he has given concerts, workshops, and master classes across North America and in Europe, and has been a featured soloist with the Toronto Symphony, Orchestra Symphonique de Montréal, and Buffalo Philharmonic. He is the percussionist for the renowned Hamilton Children's Choir, has worked as a percussion composer consultant for CBC, and taught at Acadia University. Also active in musical theater, Jamie has played drums, percussion for Mervish, Musical Stage Company, Canadian Stage, Young People's Theater, Jackie Richardson, cabaret star Sharon Matthews from CBC's Frankie Drake, and more. His solo recording night is available on New Toronto Records. So we are so lucky and thankful and grateful that we have Jamie with us today because he has a very busy schedule and has agreed to be our guest today. So welcome, Jamie, and the floor is yours. Yay!
Thank you very much. Hi, everybody. I'm very happy to be here over the internet or over the phone, as it were. It has been an interesting year for me and for many other musicians. And so it's nice to still be able to connect to people in this way, because the usual way that we connect with people is obviously not an option. And we're all very much looking forward to getting back to that. I'm especially excited because a lot of the things that you're gonna hear me play today, I pre-recorded yesterday because I found out a couple days ago that I had an appointment this morning to get my first vaccine. And I wanted to make sure, I didn't know how my arm was gonna be after that. So I pre-recorded a bunch of stuff yesterday, but especially excited about that because it seems like maybe we're starting to edge back towards having live music again, which would be really wonderful. So I am going to do something that is probably slightly insane and a bit foolhardy, which is try and talk about the whole wide world of percussion in 45 minutes or so. There is a lot to cover, and I'll sort of goes without saying that as with any large subject like this, I'm going to paint a lot of very broad strokes and skip over a bunch of things, but I will try to give you kind of an overview of some of the things that I do and some of the things that I find really interesting and why I think percussion is such a great group of instruments to play, and cover some things that a lot of people perhaps don't know about it. So a little bit about me. Thank you for that very nice intro, by the way, Nicole. I have been playing percussion for about 25 years now, I guess. And also another shout out to Dagmar Ridlow, who is my piano teacher through high school. I spent a lot of years studying piano as well. I've unfortunately lost most of my piano technique, although I do still have a keyboard right here for what I'm doing, composing and coaching over Zoom. So I still get to play a little bit, which is nice, but all my piano finger technique is gone. But Dagmar was really instrumental in helping shape sort of the musician that I've been able to become. So I'm very grateful for her, and I'm very grateful for her for connecting us today. So I played piano from a young age. My mom played piano. She would play for school choirs. But I was always one of those kids who was sort of drumming on things, drumming on tables or making drums out of overturned cans and stuff like that. And so when grade 7 band came along, I said, oh yeah, I want to play drums. And my parents, like most parents, were not super enthusiastic at first. And but thankfully my middle school music teacher lived almost across the street from us. And so she convinced them that yes, he should, yeah, let's give it a try. You don't want him to play French horn. Let's try drums. And so that's how I started. And my parents got me a kit. And I think they thought it was going to be sort of like a thing that I would grow out of. And then when it, university time came, I said, I want to do music. And my mom said, oh, great, you're going to do piano. And I said, no, I am not. I would like to do percussion. And I actually wanted to go into a jazz program, an audition for the jazz program at U of T, and was woefully underprepared for that and ended up doing, was much better prepared for my classical percussion audition. And so that's how I sort of started seriously. I also played in the Mississauga Youth Orchestra when I was a kid, and that was really helpful. But certainly university was the time when things really started to take off. And I was very lucky to study with Russell Hartenberger, who's one of the members of Nexus, which I'll talk about in a little bit. I've had a lot of really fantastic teachers. And so I did my undergrad at U of T, I did a master's at the San Francisco Conservatory, and then my doctorate in music back at U of T. And so it's been a really great journey. And the thing that I love about it is that in normal times, I get to do all sorts of different things and play in a lot of different styles. And the variety is something that I'm going to keep coming back to. It's sort of one of my favorite things about what I get to do. I think if I was like a violinist, not to say that the violin's not a beautiful instrument, but I think I would get bored very quickly with one instrument. And so getting to play all sorts of different things and all sorts of different styles is really lovely for me. It's probably a good idea to talk about what percussion is. So percussion is a very wide term, and it basically applies to instruments that are struck or hit or shaken or scraped. And so there's sort of different, depending on what system you use, there's different categories of percussion instruments. Often we, or at least in North America, Western Europe tradition, we categorize instruments by the type of material that you are striking or shaking. So there's idiophones, which are things that are made out of wood. So something like a wood block or a xylophone. Membranophones, which are basically drums, things that have skin heads or plastic that's meaning to sort of replicate natural skin. And metallophones, which are things that are metal. So things like a glockenspiel or tubular bells or a triangle would be a metallophone. We can also classify them as concert percussion, which is things that we typically find in a symphony orchestra. For example, things like the aforementioned triangle, crash cymbals, bass drum, snare drum, which I'll talk about in a little bit. World percussion, which is sort of a funny term now that everything is so connected, but typically in North America, we use that to mean things from outside of the Western classical music culture. So African instruments, Asian instruments, Latin American instruments, all that sort of thing. And found percussion, which we'll talk about a little bit as well, which is instruments that are not really designed to be instruments. There's things that come from other aspects of life that we've kind of co-opted to make sounds. And so the question is, why is percussion important? Why is it useful? Why do people like it? Why do I like it? There's a few things. A lot of this is coming from my experience is mostly in the world of kind of Western music. So both Western pop music and Western classical music. And so in those genres, one of the main things, of course, is that percussion helps establish a beat. It helps establish a groove, helps establish a rhythm. And that goes from anything from like a marching band to a Brazilian samba thing, to any pop or rock song where somebody's playing a drum set, anything that the percussion is the thing that very clearly is laying down a pulse that everybody can follow. But the other reason, and the reason that, I love all of those things. I love playing grooves, I love playing beats, I love playing things that make people dance. But the other reason why percussion is so interesting, and I think the thing that a lot of people don't think about as much outside of perhaps composers and percussionists, is the huge variety of color and texture that it can add to sound. And to me, this is the coolest thing about what I get to do, is just the variety of colors and textures and intricacies and subtleties of sound that percussion can really help with. So a super brief history here. There is percussion in almost every culture from around the world. It is one of the earliest instruments, if not the earliest instrument, although I think there's some debate about whether percussion or like a simple flute came first. But certainly a lot of it goes back like hundreds and thousands of years, basically. And one of the first things that percussion instruments were used for before they were sort of used for fun or pleasure or music was as ways of communication. And there's a couple different examples of this. There's an African instrument called the talking drum. And it's a sort of an hourglass shaped drum that has lots of strings that connect two heads on it. And basically you play it by putting it under your arm and using your arm to kind of squeeze the drum, and that actually changes the pitch of the heads. And I'll play an example in just a moment, but because you can play these different pitches, you can actually kind of imitate the cadence of human speech. And so it's called the talking drum, colloquially, because it was used to sort of imitate speech. And people in various, I think particularly West African villages, Ghana and places like that, would use it as a way between different tribes or different villages of carrying messages. Because especially if you have...
Who do we have here, the little person?
Nope. Especially if we... Especially if you have...
You're from around the corner, right? Yeah, I remember your husband walking her when she was real fussy.
I think somebody needs to mute. I'm not sure who it is. I can't see everybody all at once here.
I'm trying to find it. Sorry. Is someone on here that has a guest that's visiting in your room, perhaps?
Okay, good, got it. anyway, so yes, they would use, especially over sort of like a flat landscape sound, could carry very far. So let's see if this is going to work the way that I think it's going to work. The fun that is technology and Zoom, I'm sure everybody is well acquainted with it now. One moment here. Okay. All right, so this is a brief example of the talking drum and what it sounds like and what it looks like to play. Basically, every time I'm squeezing my arm, that's pulling on those ropes, and that's stretching the drum head, and that's making the pitch go up. It's making the pitch a little bit higher. So that's the example of a talking drum. Now, in Western culture, European culture, and also a sort of early American culture, a lot of percussion originally was used in the military. Also, for communication and as a bit of a sort of a booster, I think, for troops, for marching time, but also for giving signals in camp. Certainly in like the American and British militaries, fife and drum music was often used as a signal for like time to get up, time to eat, time to go to bed, time to march, time to whatever. There's all these calls that sort of everybody knew what they meant. And actually the drummers in the military at that time would be kids. They'd be like 10 or 12 years old. Also in other cultures, Turkey particularly, I believe, the first timpani, which you might know from an orchestra, were actually carried on horseback. They were much smaller and obviously much lighter than today, but somebody would have one on either side as they were riding a horse and would be playing that, which is pretty intense. And I would like to see that in real life, but haven't come across that yet, but kind of a cool thing. So in the military in the late 1700s, early 1800s, we had the first snare drum. And I'll talk about what makes a snare drum in a second. But I'm going to show you an example of a rope drum. And it's so called, again, because like the talking drum, it uses rope to connect the two heads. And the more you pull down on the leather ears of the rope, the tighter the heads get. It also has some natural snares, and I'll talk about that in a moment as well. And these are drums that were worn over the shoulder. As I said, they would be played as a way of communicating over the battlefield, but also communicating around camp. A side note, this is sort of a fun story about this particular drum. This was a drum that my parents got me as a graduation present, either for my undergrad or my master's, I don't remember. And it actually got stolen out of my car over 10 years ago before a Torque concert. And I literally just got it back about a week ago. Randomly, somebody found it in the dumpster and saw my name on it. Somebody else who was a drummer and called me, and I got a bunch of gear back that had been missing for a decade because somebody had stolen it and stashed it and then thrown it in a dumpster, which is a pretty wild feeling, I have to tell you. It's pretty crazy. So let's take a look at, sure I'm doing the right thing here. Great. I'm gonna share another video here. So this is an example of the rope drum. Nicole joked before when I showed her a little sample of this that I looked very somber doing it. It's a very cool instrument. It's not really one that, because it had kind of a working life rather than a like, let's play this for fun. People were often, and it was played in war, so people are often pretty serious. The piece that I'm playing is called The Downfall of Paris. Which is originally, I think it's originally a 16th century tune. It's sort of adapted a little bit. And there's normally would be a fife part or a small wooden flute part that goes along to it. And it's one of the most well-known tunes that would have been played in this era of anywhere from sort of late 1700s, American Revolution, all the way almost up to the Civil War. And let's see, here we go. Yeah, I actually have to hit share for this to work, don't I? That was Downfall of Paris on a rope drum. And I mentioned that that's called a snare drum. And you'll notice that it has kind of a characteristic sound. It doesn't sound, it has kind of a snappy sound to it. And that sound is because of the snares. And in that, the case of that drum, the snares are a material called catgut, which, disclaimer, does not actually come from cats. It's basically this sort of thin natural material that stretch across the bottom of the head. Now I have here a modern snare drum, which is much smaller. And this is the bottom of it. This one has metal snares. I don't know how well you can see through them, but so if I have the snares loose so they're not contacting the bottom of the head, the drum sounds like that. But if I flip up the lever and engage it so that the snares are against the head, when you hit the top head, the sound waves travel through the drum and they make the bottom head vibrate. And that vibration makes the snares in turn vibrate against the bottom head. Sounds like this. And so snare drum is one of those instruments that we've had in various forms. There's again, versions of it from almost every culture that has sort of evolved over over the years. And the one that I was just holding is a modern one that you would see either like as part of a drum set or in something like an orchestra. So percussion started making its way into Western orchestras in the late classical period. Before that, again, it was mostly sort of a utilitarian thing in Western music. It was used in the military, but eventually it started making its way into classical music. And one of the first composers to do this actually was Beethoven. Now, let's see. All right, okay, I think that's it. So many different apps that I'm trying to share things from here. Okay, so this is just gonna be sound. There's no video, but I'm gonna play a little bit of, it's part of the final movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. And this is one of the first times that there were instruments that were up to this considered military instruments. So a pair of small cymbals that came from like a Turkish Janissary ensemble, triangle, bass drum. It's one of the first examples, and they're played fairly softly, so they might not jump out at you, but they are in here. So I'm gonna play just a little bit of this. Oops. Kind of gives you a rough idea. It gives it a bit of a sort of a stately, sort of marchy, but a little bit lighter than a march, kind of a stately procession, but a happy one, not a somber one, I would say. And so Beethoven was one of the first people to do this. Now, subsequently, especially in the Romantic era, percussion really expanded quite a lot. And one of the composers who made the most use of percussion was Mahler. In all his symphonies, especially, he gave a lot of instruments that he used that were not at that point used in orchestral instruments. And he also often gave very specific instructions. In Symphony Number 7, I think there's a part for a whole bunch of Almglocken, which are cowbells. I think I have one here. Literally the sort of bell that a cow would wear around their neck, and he wrote a part for this because he was depicting this beautiful sort of meadow scene, and he wanted it to sound like there was cows, and so he wrote a very specific, like, here's the Almglocken, and here's the pitches that you need, and here's how to play them. One of the things that Mahler is most famous for amongst percussionists is something that is known as the Mahler box, and in the Sixth Symphony, he wanted a sound that symbolized the blows of fate, and so he basically suggested building a giant wooden box and hitting it with a massive hammer. And that is exactly as much fun as it sounds. And so I'm gonna share with you a little bit, percussionist from the West Australian Symphony Orchestra talking about this, because it's pretty cool. There's also actually, he has some in the background, there's some Almglocken in this video, and also a couple of bells that would be used for Berlioz Symphony Fantastique, really big church bells.
This is the Mahler box and hammer that we're going to use for Mahler's Sixth Symphony. When Mahler wrote it, he knew that he had these blows of fate in mind, but it was kind of fortuitous in that that actually turned out to be representative of his own life. And you know, he had the death of his firstborn daughter, and his forced resignation from Vienna Opera, and then his diagnosis of a fatal heart condition. at the time when he was writing this, it was actually a really happy time in his life. He just married his wife and his daughter was born during the composition. So it's interesting that he named it the Tragic Symphony and that he incorporated these blows of fate.
G'day.
I'm Shane Thompson, but people around here know me as Dusty. Quite some weeks back.
So that video doesn't quite fully convey how loud that can be, especially if you are another instrumentalist sitting in front of it and you forget that it's coming. There's a great, I wasn't able to find it, but somewhere on YouTube, there's a great compilation of other instrumentalists getting, like being startled by the sound of that hammer, which as a percussionist is very funny for me to watch. And so Mahler was a real pioneer in terms of percussion in the orchestra. He really expanded it in a way that other people have not done until that point. Now, of course, once we get to the beginning of the 1900s, we start to get into the development of popular music, or what we now sort of consider popular music, with ragtime and jazz and all sorts of things. And so one of the things that happened at that point was we start to develop the modern drum set, which of course I think a lot of people have seen in various concerts, whether it's jazz, whether it's rock. And at first this happened because again, like so many things, it was out of necessity versus, oh, I'd like to do something different for the sake of it. One person trying to play more than one instrument. So it developed a technique called double drumming. And this is a pretty interesting thing. It's basically incorporating a bass drum and a snare drum, but with one person. And this was before foot pedals were invented. And so it's a very interesting technique. So we're going to see a short snippet of a guy, a drum set historian named Daniel Glass, talking about this.
So the drummers that were taking this idea of playing more than one instrument at once were taking this concept of marching and started playing a bass drum and a snare drum together at the same time, but without a pedal. And they developed a really interesting technique called double drumming. You'll notice that the style that I used in playing that little demonstration.
So that's double drumming. And then the next sort of evolution from that was developing foot pedals for the bass drum. It should be noted too that a lot of the development, certainly of the drum set and of popular music and percussion within popular music, are largely come not actually from the Western classical tradition, but from African American music, from all sorts of different spiritual traditions, from music that is sort of their folk music that developed while people were enslaved on plantations and then eventually started to come more sort of out into the mainstream once people were sort of theoretically free from that. And so one of the greatest early drummers was a man named Chick Webb, who was quite small in stature, but was a serious drum set player. And I'll play a brief clip of that. This is, it's just a photo of him behind a drum set, and you can see how they called them trap kits before they called them drum sets or trap sets. And they basically, it was a way of just having a bunch of things sort of all at once. So we had the bass drum, you had a snare drum, but you also had some things like wood blocks, different cymbals, different kind of sound effects. And again, Chick Webb, a real force of nature in the 1930s in sort of the earliest big bands here.
Thank you.
So a real, as I said, a real force of nature. It's kind of still amazing to me to think that one guy is doing all of that at the same time. He's had incredible, incredible technique. Then sort of from there, in terms of the drum set, things got refined in terms of sizes and placements. Bass drums got a little smaller, cymbals got a little bigger, better technology started coming out. And the other thing that happened was, of course, I'm gonna not play any examples by them today, but you get the great great drummers like Buddy Rich and Gene Krupa with their big bands who played incredible drum solos and really knew how to drive a big band. Just, again, incredible technique and just really made drums a sort of a focal point and very exciting. Then as you get later on into jazz and into, you get into bebop, and then you get into sort of more more modern branches from that, drummers started using drums in terms of soloing, not only as a rhythmic thing, but started trying to incorporate the melody of a drum set. And what I mean by that is using different pitches of the elements in a kit to try and sort of make a melody, even though it's not the sort of thing that you might sing. It's not a typical pitch melody like a... But it still has its own sort of contour and shape. And so what I'm going to share with you next is a really great drummer by the name of Elvin Jones, who played with John Coltrane for a long time. Really famous drummer who unfortunately passed away a few years ago now. And just a very different sounding sounding drum solo here. So definitely a different style of playing and also a different sound of a drum set. Just the drums are a little bit higher, everything's a little bit clearer, it kind of has more punch, but also you can hear more different tones within that drum set. All right. In terms of chamber music, sort of jumping back to Western classical music traditions, there wasn't really any sort of music for groups of unpitched instruments until the 1930s. And there was a number of composers, contemporary music composers of that time, who became interested in percussion as sort of a new frontier of sound. Also, of course, at that point, mechanization was something that was starting to really affect the way that cities ran and that life directed, the reliance more on machines than on human power. And so composers were often sort of equating the sounds of percussion with the sounds of this kind of more modern life that we were in. And so there's a composer named Edgar Varèse wrote a piece called Ionization, which is sort of one of the first percussion ensemble pieces. It involves, I think, 15 people, and it has all sorts of different instruments, everything from snare drums to maracas to a couple of chimes to an electronic buzzer, all sorts of different things. Other composers named Henry Cowell and Lou Harrison, Joanna Beyer, they were all instrumental in making percussion a thing that sort of stood on its own as forces to write for. One of the most famous people to write for percussion, and one of the people who brought it sort of more into the mainstream, was an American composer named John Cage. And he wrote a lot of his percussion music in the late 1930s and early 1940s. He's perhaps best known, he's a very large figure in sort of 20th century American music. He's perhaps maybe best known to the general public for a piece called 4:33, in which you literally go to an instrument and you sit there and don't do anything for 4 minutes and 33 seconds. And it's sort of a commentary on the nature of what is music and what is sound and what makes a musical composition. Is it just the things that people are playing, or is it all the sounds that are happening at the same time. He was really interested in all sorts of sound and how any kind of sound could be music. And so, of course, because of this, he was drawn to non-pitched percussion. And one of the pieces that he wrote is a piece called The Third Construction, was written in 1939. And still to this day, one of the most performed percussion quartets, uses a bunch of really interesting instruments, things that were designed to be percussion instruments, such as what's called Chinese tom-toms and woodblocks, various types of rattles and shakers, but also things that fall under the found percussion category that I mentioned before. So that would include things, for example, like tin cans. Everybody in this piece has a set of 5 tin cans. And when Torque performs it, we use different things. Some of us use paint cans, some of us use old food cans, some of us use mini beer kegs, actually, which work really well. So there's sort of a whole variety of things that can be used. So I'm going to play just a brief excerpt of Third Construction here. It's got a really, to me, very beautiful and very unique sound to it. Kind of start it somewhere in the middle here. Oops, sorry. That's not what I meant to do. I've been on Zoom so much and yet I still sometimes don't know what I'm doing. I apologize. That's what I wanted to do. All right. So here's a little bit of Third Construction. There are those tin cans. You a rough idea. The whole piece is about, well, depending on how fast you play it, between about 11 and 14 minutes long. A pretty neat piece. That was actually a recording of Torque from our second album playing that. So there is a lot of development in the sort of the 1940s, 1950s and 60s, not so much. Composers at that point were focused on surrealism and atonalism, and there was pieces that were written, but they tended to be pretty inaccessible. They largely sort of abandoned the idea of groove and pulse and were very sort of abstract. But then back in the 1970s, percussion really started to become a focus again. A lot of that was because of a couple things. One was the rise of minimalism in Western classical music. And so that's a branch of music which focuses on small rhythmic cells and repeating patterns and gradual changes over time. In particular, there's a composer named Steve Reich who wrote a lot of percussion music. There's a piece called Drumming, which in total is about an hour long, a really beautiful piece. There's a whole website about it actually, drummingat50.com, because it just had its 50th anniversary. There's another piece that he wrote called Pieces of Wood. There's another piece called Clapping Music. So that was something that sort of helped spark it. As well, there's the formation of this group Nexus, which I mentioned earlier. Two of my teachers were part of this, and they were really sort of the first modern North American percussion ensemble, and played a sort of bewildering variety of music. They were interested in the fife and drum music that I've talked about before, Japanese music, free improvisation, but also ragtime. Ragtime played on xylophone was a really big thing back in the 1920s and then kind of fell out of fashion as recording techniques got better and you didn't need the sound of a xylophone to cut through. But Nexus almost single-handedly revived that that tradition. And so there's a great video of them playing a little bit of ragtime here with Bob Becker as the soloist. He's one of the members. And just really incredible, incredible technique. And I've seen them play this many times in person, and I always sort of can't believe that anybody's hands can move that fast in real life. It's very impressive, I have to say. So this is a little bit of Nexus playing some ragtime, playing the wonderfully titled piece, Fluffy Ruffles. If there was a better name for a piece of music, I don't think I've ever heard it. Just incredible musicianship and obviously amazing technique. And that music is just so fun and so joyous and so uplifting. So speaking of ragtime, this is probably, I should mention too that as Nicole mentioned and I've referenced briefly, I'm in a group called TORQ, T-O-R-Q Percussion Quartet. And we've kind of taken on, we're certainly inspired by Nexus and have sort of tried to carry on some of their traditions. And so we often now will write our own music as well as commissioning people and adapting music, which I'll talk about in a little bit. And so the tradition of percussion music is really growing, especially with all university programs happening in the last few decades. Percussion ensemble is now sort of alive and well, still not as popular in the mainstream as something like a string quartet, but we're working on it. We're trying to get it there. I'll maybe play some more stuff from TORQ right at the end. I know I'm probably already going to run a little bit over time, so I'll see how much time we have at the end. I'd like to talk a little bit about some of the instruments. So you just saw some mallet instruments, and mallet instruments are kind of a group. On that video that we just saw, Bob Becker was playing a xylophone, and the other members of Nexus were playing marimbas, and they look and sound very similar. And the differences between them are relatively minor. They both have wooden keys or wooden bars, but a xylophone is a little bit higher and the sound is sharper because of the way that it's tuned. The marimba is bigger, the bar is a little bit bigger. It has a much wider range. Now you can get marimbas 5 or 5.5 octaves. And because of the way the bars are tuned, the sound is a little bit mellower. And another instrument that I'm gonna, I made a video about that I really love, one of my favorite mallet percussion instruments is the vibraphone. So I'm going to try and find that here. So I'm going to talk in this video, I'm going to talk a little bit about it and talk about how it works and play some music on it. This is one of my favorite mallet percussion instruments, or keyboard percussion as we sometimes call it. This is called the vibraphone, and there are a lot of different mallet percussion instruments. Vibraphone is one of the more common ones, mostly because it is one of the only mallet instruments that is at least semi-regularly used in jazz. There are also other instruments called the marimba, the glockenspiel, crotales, and I'll maybe talk about some of those a little bit later. But for now, the vibraphone. This is a 3-octave instrument. And for those of you who are familiar with the piano and the way it's laid out, the bars on this instrument are laid out in the same way, so that we have the naturals all along this bottom, what would be the white keys on a piano keyboard. And then the accidentals, the sharps or flats, along the top, grouped in twos and threes. This instrument has a 3-octave range. So it goes from just below, about a fifth below what middle C would be in a piano, to 3 octaves above that, F to F. And the cool thing about the vibraphone is, well, first of all, it has metal bars, so it can sustain for quite a long time. And very much like a piano, it has a damper pedal. So you can use that to control the length of the sustain. So just like on a piano, if you play a note and then you take your hand off the key and you're not holding down that pedal, the note is quite short. It only sustains for however long you have your hand on the key. If you hold down the pedal, the note is longer. And that same thing happens on a vibraphone as well. It's a damper pedal, although I know you can't see it in this video, so you have to trust me that it's here. And if I take, these are called mallets, these are the some of the types of sticks that we use to play this instrument. If I take a mallet and I do not have my foot on the pedal and I just hit a note, it's quite short. However, if I hold my foot down on this pedal and hit that same note, then it actually sustains for quite a long period of time. It can really sustain for a while before it decays. And this works because there's a felt strip that runs in between the bars here. And when I press down on the pedal, that takes the felt strip away from the bars. When I release my foot off the pedal, the felt strip is now touching the bars, and that dampens it. The other cool thing about the vibraphone and the thing that sets it apart from other mallet instruments is that it has a motor in it. And this is actually sort of where the name comes from. The vibraphone has to do with the fact that this instrument can play what's called a vibrato. And a vibrato is a technique that sort of varies either the amplitude or the volume or the pitch of a note and gives it a kind of wah, 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 wah sound, which if you've ever seen a really great violinist play when they sort of are doing this with their hands, or certainly singers use this technique all the time. Most percussion instruments cannot do vibrato, but this one can. And the reason that it can is because it has a motor built in. Now these tubes on the front, these are called resonator tubes, and those tubes are a lot of what gives the vibraphone its sound. If it weren't for that, the instrument would sound very thin and not nearly as loud. What happens is when you hit the bars, the sound waves go into those tubes and the special length of the tube helps amplify it. It's a natural acoustic amplifier. Now, what the motor does is there's actually little fans. I don't know how well you can see it on the video, but there's fans that live inside of these tubes. And when I flip the switch, the motor rotates those fans. And so what it does is it's actually opening and closing the entrance to the resonator tube. And that gives it this sense of vibrato. So if I have the motor not on and I hit a note or a couple of notes, it's a very, what we call a straight tone or a straight sound. There's no sort of fluctuation in it other than gradually the volume or the amplitude will decrease over time. But if I turn on the motor, which has some different speeds here, this motor is a little bit noisy sometimes. Probably due for a tune-up. Let's get it slow first. So now, when I hit those same notes, listen to the difference in the sound. You can start to hear that vibrato effect. And if I increase the speed a little bit, you can really start to hear it. And this particular instrument, the vibrato goes up to quite fast. It kind of has that sort of 1960s sci-fi movie kind of vibe to it. All in all, a really neat effect, and one that can be used in a lot of different ways. Sometimes you'll vary the speed as you go. Sometimes you'll turn it off, sometimes you'll turn it on, sometimes you just leave it. All sorts of different things you can do about it. Now, I've talked already about how one of the great things about percussion to me is just the variety of colors that it provides and that are possible. And that is really probably my favorite thing about percussion is having the opportunity to really get into some of those subtle differences that can really influence kind of the mood or the feel of a piece. And one of the ways that we do that with mallet instruments and with drums as well is by using different implements to play. And so I've been using this set of four mallets, and often with mallet instruments, we actually will play two in each hand, as you'll see in a minute. And these are what I would call medium or medium hard mallets. This is they're wrapped in cord, and you can get them in all sorts of different colors, as you'll see in a second. And so these have a specific sound. It's a pretty full sound, but also a pretty strong attack. As soon as you hit it, you can hear that sound right away, and it sounds fairly, if I play it pretty loud, fairly forceful, I would say. Having said that, there are lots of other things that you can use on a vibraphone to get different colors. And so if you use different hardnesses of mallets, that's kind of the main way that you can get different sounds and different colors. Now, as percussionists, certainly I'll try and show a picture of this later, but we all own tons of different mallets. Like, I think I have hundreds of pairs of different mallets, and I probably have 10 or 12 different sets of vibraphone mallets, because they all do give a slightly different sound color. And to help distinguish those, often they actually have real world sort of visual colors as well, to sort of, so that I can keep track of which is which. So here's another, some more selection of mallets. Most of these are also wrapped either with yarn or cord. And so just by way of comparison, this is the mallet that we started off with. Has a certain sound. Now you can get much softer mallets that make the sound a lot mellower and make it just, you don't hear the attack quite as much, and you hear the sound kind of spreads out a little bit more rather than starting all at once. And so these sound something like this. Now I'm using the same amount of force to play, so it would still be what I would consider playing the same dynamic, but you can tell there's obviously a pretty drastic difference in sound. You can also get extremely hard mallets. We don't use these that often, but if you're, for example, playing a piece with an orchestra and you really need something to cut through, it has its specific use. So as you can tell, again, a very different sound, very sort of bright and glassy, I would describe it. The attack is really, really present. And then finally, you can also use mallets that that aren't wrapped, and they have their own sound as well. This is just like a hard, I believe a hard rubber sort of mallet. Sort of sounds like the very, very hard wrapped one. And so all these things kind of go in a continuity. There's a whole range of things. You can use other implements as well. Sometimes we've even played them with metal chopsticks or wooden chopsticks or the backs of mallets. It gives its own, again, very different sound. Kind of very thin, but again, sort of a nice effect. One of the most interesting ways, though, is not to use mallets at all. And this is another sort of a cool trick that, again, works best on vibraphone. You can also bow, glockenspiel, and grottales, and even marimba, but vibraphone is where you really have the effect. These are a couple of old bass bows, actually. And the great thing about things that vibrate, like a vibraphone bar, particularly if they're finished, is that in the same way that a string player draws a bow across the string and that causes the string to vibrate, you can do the same thing on a vibraphone bar. And it gets a really beautiful sound. It sounds something like this. So again, kind of a different and unusual technique, but a really lovely and beautiful sound, I think. Now, in terms of the music that we play on this instrument, it really varies. Like a lot of percussion instruments and percussion music, there certainly isn't the centuries of repertoire like you'd find on something like the violin or piano or orchestra or things like that. And while there is certainly a lot more music specifically being written for example, a solo vibraphone or a vibraphone within a percussion ensemble or a small chamber context. And there's a lot of, as I mentioned, there's a lot of jazz that's played on a vibraphone. The nice thing about it is that sort of like a piano, although it doesn't have the same range, you can play a melody and sort of accompany yourself a little bit. cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I am, although I love jazz playing, I'm not really a jazz vibraphonist, so I'm not the best person to demonstrate that, but you can certainly play some beautiful chords. So now, one of the things, though, that I love to do with this instrument is actually take music that was written by a composer who lived many years ago, many centuries ago, in fact. But his music works on all sorts of different instruments, and that's one of the things that to me is so genius about it. I'm talking about J.S. Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, and a lot of the things that he's written for solo instruments, particularly the cello suites, violin sonatas and partitas, lute suites, things like that, work really beautifully on these instruments. And the melodic and harmonic content in Bach is so lovely that I think it's a really great way to learn almost any instrument. And so right now I'm going to perform a slightly adapted, just because of the range, version of part of the Bach cello suite. Number one in G major. So that is a little bit, or a lot actually, about the vibraphone. As I said, it's one of my favorite instruments, so I was sort of happy to have an excuse to chat about it and play it for a bit. I just want to check in about time right now. I know we're at about an hour. I am happy to keep going because I still have lots more things I could talk about, another couple of videos to share. But I do understand if people have to leave. So Nicole, are we okay to keep going for a little bit?
I think we're okay to go. Sure. If you have the time as well, then mm-hmm. maybe you can just give us a cue and then we'll address any questions or open it up to questions.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, sure.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. So as I mentioned a couple times, the variety of color in percussion instruments is really one of the things that I love. And so another group of instruments that I really enjoy very much are what are called frame drums. And those are something that I'm gonna talk a little bit about in this next video. It's not as long as the vibraphone video, but I do get to go through a couple of different drums here. So let's see.
Frame drums is the name for a group of instruments that spans many different cultures. And many different styles.
Sorry. Trying to do too many things at once here. Let's try this again. There we go.
Frame drums is the name for a group of instruments that spans many different cultures and many different styles. And basically a frame drum is a single-headed drum around, usually around wooden frame, although sometimes you can have square ones as well. In this case, this is a generic drum called a tar that I have that's kind of a Middle Eastern origin, although this one was American made. And as you can see, it's quite shallow, has a head on one side. And on the other side, this one actually has some strings, which can give it a sound effect, but that's kind of the rough structure or dimensions of a frame drum, something that's quite shallow, a single head, and a sort of basic frame drum, like many other hand percussion instruments, can get different sounds. There's some sort of a low sound, and there's some sort of a high sound, and then there's also sometimes like a snap sound. And depending on the culture that you come from, there's different syllables to express those sounds. Often it's doom is a low sound, like in a Middle Eastern culture. And tek is a high sound. Pa also represents holding your hand to sort of mute the drum to get a muted sound. And so a frame drum like this is going to sound something like this. As I mentioned, frame drums have spanned many different cultures, and there's many different examples from all over the world. And some frame drums have jingles in them, which are like little, tiny, usually metal circles that are sort of inserted into the frame. And that's something that might sound a bit weird and exotic, but actually almost everybody has seen one. The common tambourine is an example of a frame drum, and often tambourine is sort of the name of the generic name of the group of frame drums that has these jingles. So I'm going to show you three different examples of tambourines from all over the world. The first is the one that you might be most used to seeing. This is a concert tambourine, the sort of thing that you'd use in an orchestra or a symphony or a wind ensemble. And again, it has a single head. This one has jingles that are made out of copper, I believe. And lots of double jingles around, so you can get a very nice jingle sound. And you play it with a bunch of different techniques. You might hit it. You might do something called a thumb roll, which is where you use friction to make your thumb bounce around the edge. And you might shake it, and it sounds a little something like this. So that's a concert tambourine. Next up, we have this instrument called a rik, R-I-Q, and this is found in the Middle East, particularly Turkey, Iraq, places like that. And again, similar in sort of general shape, but fewer jingles, and they're much heavier. These are made out of hammered bronze, I believe. And again, a different sound and a different playing technique from the concert tambourine. finally, we're going to talk about one more tambourine. This was from Brazil. This is called the pandeiro. And again, this is a sort of modern North American contemporary version of it. But this is often used in a bunch of different types of samba. If anyone has ever watched any of the Rio Carnival celebrations, you might see this. It's used, as I said, a lot of samba music. It's also been adapted into bossa nova. And the cool thing about this one is that it has quite a range of tones. And you can almost play like a drum set part. You can have a low sound that sounds sort of like a bass drum or a kick drum, higher sound that sounds something like a snare drum. And if, again, you've probably heard some of these sorts of sounds if you've ever listened to any like Brazilian jazz, it's often present in that kind of thing. So it sounds something like this. And again, a very different playing technique. Whereas the rick was held up and played like this, this one more like the concert tambourine is played flat, but it uses a combination of thumb and fingers and this kind of rotating in the heel of your hand as well. Sounds like this. So those are just some examples of frame drums and tambourines in particular that you might find from all over the world, and they each have kind of their own place and their own really unique and beautiful color to them. That is a little bit about frame drums. Now there are, it would take weeks for me to go through all the different types of percussion instruments and talk about all the different varieties. So there are literally thousands, I guess. I don't know. I mean, I own very many. I own a lot of instruments. I'm not sure what the total is. I'm very lucky to have a very patient partner and very patient family members, because a lot of certainly this whole room that you can't maybe quite see, I'll try and lift up. The drum set over there, and lots of things over there, lots of things on the shelf here, and the rest of the basement also filled with other instruments. But I thought I'd just talk about a few of my favorite sort of unusual ones that you probably wouldn't see elsewhere, and then maybe we can do a quick Q&A. One of the things that I really love, and I have always loved since I was a kid, is bells, like metal ringing things. I love the sound of them. I've been fascinated by all the different types. I love the varieties. I love the way they look. And so I've collected kind of a lot of those. And I also want to share just briefly here, one of my favorite pictures of me. This was on a trip to Shanghai a few years ago. And it was like, just maybe like one of the greatest moments of my life. Was seeing this ginormous bell at the Xinjiang, I think I'm pronouncing that right, temple in Shanghai. I really wanted to take it home, obviously highly impractical for a lot of reasons, but it was just such a beautiful instrument. And in fact, if anyone has ever been to Ontario Place, they still kind of on the lake side of the Cinesphere, there's a really beautiful, quite large Japanese temple bell that's hung up there. Sort of randomly, and it's also really beautiful. And I've been lucky enough to collect some cool ones. Some of these came from one of my teachers. There's a bigger version of this, but I'm not going to lift up because it's really heavy and my arms are still a bit sore from this morning. But this is, I believe this is a Chinese bell with some really beautiful kind of engravings and sculpture on it, almost like a dragon motif. And it has kind of a cool sound because it actually sort of has two notes at once. Let me get an actual mallet here, which will make it sound a bit better, hopefully. So depending on where I hit it, there's actually different pitches. So that's kind of cool. There's also, again, thanks to my teacher, speaking of found percussion, this is part of an old artillery shell. And again, has a really just beautiful bell-like sound when you strike it with a mallet.
really kind of pure and lovely. Again, this is also quite heavy, so I'm going to put that down now. And oh yeah, this is another fun, unusual found percussion instrument. A bunt pan of aluminum. Plastic ones don't work for this. But if you hit it again, a cool sort of bell sound. And with this one especially, because of a phenomenon known as the Doppler effect, if you move it, you can actually get kind of a sort of vibrato like we were talking about earlier with the vibraphone, a bit of a different effect, but. And this came to me from one of the members of Nexus. We've been lucky enough, all the guys in Torque, been lucky enough to sort of inherit some of their instruments, which is special to us, not only because they're just beautiful instruments, but because they were our teachers, and it's sort of nice to feel like you're carrying on the work. Cymbals. I actually made a whole video about cymbals, which we don't need to see because we don't have that much time left. But I do. I love cymbals. I have literally, I want to say 120 of them maybe, because they're all very different. I know, I think John said maybe that he was a drummer, so he probably knows what I'm talking about here, but there's a whole huge variety. Let's see if I can kind of see some of them on there. There's shelves and shelves and shelves, and they're all sort of different sounds. I'll just quickly grab a couple. Everything from a little splash cymbal here. To something that's a little bit bigger. We call this type of cymbal a ride cymbal, and it's often used in jazz, and it has a much clearer articulation so that it gets quite a bit bigger, as you can see. It's a much clearer articulation so that you can play patterns on it and you'll be able to hear them. It doesn't just end up sounding like, you can actually hear the rhythm that you're playing. So I think probably I have, well, let's just say more ride cymbals than probably one human needs to have, but there you have it. This is one really interesting cymbal called a spiral stacker. Looks like this. And it's like a cymbal that has a cut all the way through it. And if you hit it, again, really kind of a neat shimmery sound. Very different from all the others. Speaking of ringing metal things, one more thing I wanted to mention. I referenced these by name a little bit. This is called a Kritali. It's a very thin but quite heavy metal disc. And they're pitched just like a glockenspiel would be. Just going to duck out here to grab a mallet. And they just have a really beautiful kind of sparkly sound. They sound a little bit like a glockenspiel, but with a little bit more sparkle. And so you can actually, normally these would be mounted on a stand and you have two octaves of them. It's just this really beautiful, pure sound. I don't know, hopefully that's not too loud through the microphone, but at least from here, it's just a really beautiful, pure kind of sparkly sound. And so you can have a whole octave of those. As percussionists, we're also often sort of called on to play some more unusual sound effect-y type things. This is definitely not a percussion instrument, but it's something that we end up playing sometimes. Torque uses it in school shows when we're trying to be a little bit goofy, and there are pieces that call for this, like duck calls and bird calls. Can never remember which way to blow into this one. No, other way. Etc., etc. And this is a cool one, and I have to admit I'm blanking on the actual name of what this is, but some people call it a frog call. It has, I believe, a Thai name, and I cannot recall it right now for the life of me, but this is kind of a cool instrument that you basically, again, it works on friction. So this is a little tiny drum head here. It's got a thin piece of fishing line attached to it. And that is wrapped around a stick with a notch. And the notch has a little bit of rosin in it, like you would put on a string bow. And as you turn this, it makes the string vibrate. makes the head vibrate. And it sounds like either sort of croaking frogs, or somebody described it as the sound of like a boat kind of creaking in the harbor when it's moored up. And it's just a, again, sort of a sound effect, but a really cool, to me, a really cool and beautiful sound. Kind of a neat little thing there. Going back to pitch instruments, have things called a kalimba. It's a sort of a mini, again, a mini modern version, but they're metal tines that you pluck them and it sort of resonates. This is a modern version of I want to say East African, certainly an African instrument. I think it's East African. And the last instrument I'll show you is one that is kind of a favorite of mine because it's so simple. It's literally basically a wooden box. It's called a cajon, and it's something that you sit on. It's originally Afro-Peruvian, but it sort of came to popularity through flamenco music, and now it's used in all sorts of different styles. And it's great because it's literally sort of a drum set in that you can sit on, literally a whole drum set in a box. I'm gonna see if I can adjust my camera here, try and move this out of the way. So this is the cajon. It's hollow, it's got a hole here, which is where the sound kind of, the bass, the lower frequencies kind of build up and come out of. And you just sit right on it. And you can get, like we're talking about the frame drums, you can get both low and high sounds. So like with a lot of hand drums, if you play more in the center, you get a lower sound. If you play towards the edge, you get a higher sound. And this particular one sounds like this. That's sort of a brief overview of some of the instruments that I love. And I also just wanted to show, these are a couple of buckets of mallets. This is literally just xylophone glockenspiel mallets here. So that gives you kind of an idea of the variety. And these are some of the other sort of a variety of vibraphone mallets. And then in here we have, oh, I left the bass drum one on the floor there, but the red one is a gong beater. Oh, I should put this back up here. Got a gong beater. We have a hammer for tubular bells or chimes. It's like a rawhide mallet. Have a couple of timpani mallets, sort of general timpani mallets, and a wooden bass drum mallet for like a really hard kind of smacky sound. And then also a much heavier, sort of thumpier bass drum mallet. All right. I think probably, again, I could talk probably all afternoon about this, but I think probably we should wrap it up there. Right at the very end, I might play a torque video, but now's probably a good time to have a question and answer spot.
Okay, perfect. So if anyone has any questions, you can either use the chat box to put your question in there or raise your hand. In the meantime, I just want to say I'm very impressed with how you made a tambourine sound like, actually, to me, it sounded like three different instruments being played at the same time, which was quite impressive.
Well, thank you.
So that was, yeah. So I'm not sure if you can see them. So
I did get one that was sent directly to me, actually.
Okay, go ahead. Sure.
Which was how do you notate drumming for composition? And that's a really great question. There's the fun / sometimes not fun thing about that is that there's actually not one answer. So one of the challenges is that there is some standards. There are some standards for certain things. So for example, vibraphone or any of the pitch instruments, you just write it as you would a piano. In some cases, they're what's called transposing instruments. So that for those of you who are familiar with orchestra, sometimes you have, like, you hear about a saxophone being in E flat, or a clarinet being in B flat, or a French horn being in F. Some percussion instruments, like the high ones, particularly xylophone, crotales, glockenspiel, are transposing instruments, but just by an octave. So you would read something as a middle C, but if you play the middle C on that instrument, it actually sounds two octaves higher than a middle C on a piano. But you would still write it in, like, a treble clef, or for a marimba, which has a bigger range, you'd write it on a bass clef. For drum set, there's kind of a standard notation where a kick drum is usually one space and a snare drum is usually one space and a cymbal is an X note head over top. But for other things, it's often, there's not necessarily a standard. So one of the challenges is figuring out how to relearn how to read music, particularly when you're playing a multi-percussion piece. And actually, in one moment, I'm gonna grab a piece of music so that I can demonstrate this. Okay, I have it here. So this is actually what's called a multi-percussion solo that I wrote as part of a compilation. Multi-percussion just is kind of a term for putting a bunch of different percussion instruments together in one setup that one person can play. And so I don't know if this is backwards for you, but I'm gonna hold it up to the screen. So for each of those sort of notes with black heads on them, each of them is a different drum. So the bottom one is a bass drum, and then I think it goes conga, snare drum, and two bongos. At the very top, the notes with the X heads are triangles. And so there's a whole page that sort of says this as part of the score. But that is one of the challenges, is that it's sort of like if you're a pianist and every time somebody said, like, oh, for this piece, actually, you know how normally D is here? Well, now it's gonna be up here. And B is actually gonna be on this space instead of that line. And G is actually gonna be over here. So it's like how to sort of relearning how to read a little bit. So that's a very rough idea. And in this case, I'll just show this page one more time. This clef here, these two lines, that's called the percussion clef. And so that basically indicates that rather than reading a pitch, like something on a scale, that you're reading some sort of like non-pitched percussion instruments, things that don't have a note, letter, sort of singable note assigned to them. Hopefully that makes sense. I got another couple of, let's see, Mahler's box made very different sounds. Was it just the amount of force that made the sound different sound, or some other technique? It's probably the amount of force in a given box. It might also depend on exactly where he's striking and whether he's striking. I don't know if I have a good example. I can maybe use this. I know he had, this isn't obviously the same mallet that he was using, but actually, too many things here now. Oh yeah, there we go. So let's pretend that this is the box. If you hit it dead on like this, that's gonna give a different sound than if you hit it like that, because you're gonna have a much bigger point of impact, which is gonna sound fuller, but maybe not as sharp, versus if you hit it here, you're not gonna get the low sort of fundamental sound as much, but you are going to get sharper overtones. And also he had, on that video, he had a little bit of cloth or something on there too, to maybe take away some of those super high sharp sounds. So that's different ways that you could theoretically get a different sound. And also, of course, yeah, depending on how hard you hit it, the more force that you put into it, the more you let both the energy that you put in and the gravity of that big heavy hammer do its work, the louder it's going to be. And the other question from John, do you have many styles of percussion instruments that make the sound through only hitting or tapping? I have an electronic drum kit. Do you know if there have been advancements about the sounds available to replace the basic electronic drum kit sounds? Yes. That's a whole other discussion, but there's lots of really great sampled sounds now. Basically, there's ways of triggering sounds that were recorded acoustically, but triggering them electronically. Electronic drum kits have come a long way in the past 2 decades, and in the past, I would say 5 or 6 years especially, you can get them to sound quite realistic. The thing that's challenging about an electronic drum kit is it doesn't feel the same to play. And you still can't quite get some of the subtleties, especially on cymbals. But in terms of the actual sound, in fact, a lot of musicals now, particularly if it's like a rock musical where otherwise the drums would be extremely, extremely loud. Often now percussionists or drummers in musicals are playing some or all of their setup electronically because it's just easier for the sound guys to handle.
Okay. So I'll just put out a last call here. If anyone has any other questions for Jamie, I'll just do a little scan here to see if I see any hands up. Okay, just going to scan. Nope. Okay, and I don't see anything else in the chat box other than thank you. And
that was fabulous. Fascinating. Fabulous.
Show. Thank you.
Yes. So, yeah, so if you would
thank
like
you so
to.
Much.
If you'd like to unmute yourself, and I just want to thank Jamie, perhaps we can unmute ourselves and give him a round of applause for performing. That was wonderful, especially since you got your vaccine today, because I know the sore arm thing, over a week and mine is still sore. Not that sore, but it's still like, oh, right.
I have to admit, when I got the notification, I had a brief thought of like, oh, I have to do this presentation. Should I put it off? And I said,
No,
I'm looking forward to the presentation, but I'm definitely going to take this this slide. So I'm glad it worked out.
Yeah.
If I could be just take a minute to do a brief bit of self-promotion. If you're interested in the things that I do, there's a couple of other things you can check out if you would like to. There's lots of Torque videos and music available. If you Google Torque Percussion, T-O-R-Q. Percussion, or you can go to torquepercussion.ca. You can also purchase our albums. We have 4 albums out, and maybe I'll play something from one of those sort of on our way out. You can purchase those through a site called Bandcamp, bandcamp.com. And this is a really great resource for buying music in a way that the money actually gets to the artists instead of things like Spotify, which it definitely does not get to the artist. Yeah. I also have my own website. It's jamiedrake.ca, which is easy to remember because that's my name. And there's links to my solo album there as well. So if you'd like to check out any of that stuff, that would be great. We would appreciate it. It's a tough time for musicians right now, and we all miss playing. And I mean, before the pandemic, playing live or doing rehearsals or basically making music with people in the same room was 95% of my income. So I would be very much looking forward to when things get back to that being able to be a possibility. But thanks everybody for listening and for joining in today.
Thank you. It was wonderful.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. It gave us the opportunity to meet you and for you to be with us today. Although you're not able to perform, we gave us the opportunity to do that. And I want to thank you for opening our world to your world of percussion. So thank you very much, because I really didn't know much of it before this, and did learn some fascinating information about some of the instruments and just the sound. So I want to thank you for being our guest this afternoon. And for everyone, thank you for joining us as well. And just before we do leave, I'd like to mention that we do have another presentation coming up on May 18th. It's a Tuesday at 1:30. I'll just a little to show you.